So this evening, welcome everybody back. Weather's changed a little bit since we left. It feels like it's colder outside from when we left a little bit ago. This evening, we're going to continue along with our lesson that we had here this morning on the law of Christ. And I have to get through, I thought I set that up on the right slide. So bear with my technical difficulties here. I don't know how that happened. Okay. So, in review this morning, we spoke for a few moments about the law of Christ. And the first thing we said about the law of Christ is that there is one. You know, it is mentioned in the scriptures. And as a matter of fact, when we look at Galatians 6:2, as we did this morning, talking about bearing one another's burdens and so fulfill the law of Christ. And we said that since it is mentioned there, you can necessarily infer that there is a law of Christ. And we compared that, or at least contrasted that, let's say, with the old law, and made the note that the law of Christ is not the Mosaic law, and there are those differences, and different things are expected. It's still an obedience that is expected by the Lord's people, but we are not under the bondage of those the requirements that we see in the Old Testament law. So it is not the law of Moses. The law of Christ is better. It is something that we should be thankful for each and every day, that we are under this new law, that we are able to take hold of the hope of Christ in a much easier way, really. But oftentimes we make it difficult because we seek our own will rather than the Lord's. But this law of Christ, it is better, and it makes us free. It sets us free. There is no condemnation in Christ, as we looked at this morning. And we are not to continue in the flesh, but walk according to the Spirit. So as we move on with a few more points about the law of Christ, you can say that it is the gospel. When we look at Romans 1, verse 16, we read, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God to salvation for everyone who believes, for the Jew first, and also for the Greek." And that's the wonderful thing about the law of Christ, is that it is extended to all men. The Lord desires that all men come to the knowledge of Him, and all means all. And that is something that the old law was lacking. But the law of Christ fixed that. It is the gospel of Christ. It is the thing that can save every man from himself, really. The gospel is the God-breathed word. In John 14, verse 26, we read that the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all things that I said to you. Now, this morning we talked about context, and realizing in context, this is Christ speaking to a specific group of people who was going to have the Helper come to them and help them to remember all the things that he had said to them while he was with them and in his ministry and on his journey through the last few years of his life. And through that, through this very thing that is being spoken of here in John 14, we have the Word. Those men had the Helper to help them remember all things, and they in turn wrote the Word that we see in front of us. The Word is, in fact, the God-breathed Word, and this is how: because the Holy Spirit helped them to remember. These things were spoken by Christ, and then the Helper, another part of the Godhead, helped them to understand and remember those things, and they put it in writing for us to see. Now, in some religions we hear of traditions that are passed down by word of mouth, We hear about the legends and so on in a lot of these ancient religions. And what's the problem with that? Why do you think that it was in the wisdom of God to put this in writing so that we could see it and understand it and see it alike throughout generations, that we can compare? We have archaeological sites that we can look back to and see the writings that are uncovered in these archaeological sites, compare them to what we have and see that it's the same, and see that the Lord's will is being completed just as he said, that these things will continue. And if we were to have left it to man and his own mind to say these things from generation to generation, it would be something like, I would imagine that it would be something like the game of telephone. Did you ever play that in elementary school, where you have a long group of people and you tell someone at this end something, and by the time you get to the other end with them whispering it to each other in their ears, you get something completely different down here? We don't have that with the word. The law of Christ, the gospel, it is the God-breathed word. It is unchanged and it is able to save our souls. And Acts 20, verse 32 reminds us of that. So now, brethren, I commend you to God and the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and to give you an inheritance among all those who are sanctified. It is able to do what it was sent to do. Now, and one of the things that I think we can get out of it from our daily study, and we should be studying and looking into the word daily, realizing I know that, you know, our lives get busy, and I know that sometimes it feels like there's just no time. But we understand that the word builds us up. The word helps us to make it through those difficult times. And if you need anything in life, it is a building up in a spiritual way, building up the kind of building up that only the Lord can do and only his word can do. Now, when we come together like we have now twice on this day, we are built up by one another. And part of that building up is that we've been looking into the word together, and that is, of course, helpful. But we can't overlook the fact that the word builds us up, and it allows us to have that inheritance among those who are sanctified. We read earlier today about being sanctified in Christ. And that is exactly what can happen when we follow the law of Christ. Those that are in Christ are sanctified by him. Another thing to remember, and it's something that I know I mention almost like a broken record over and over again, is Matthew 28, 18, which points out that Christ has all authority. The law of Christ is by his authority. It bears his name. And when we look at the things that we're told to do in the scriptures, they are things that the Lord has asked directly of us, that we can trust it because it is of his authority. Now, as much as mankind tries to change things about it and would like to change the law of Christ, man cannot change it. You know, if mankind had a hold of it and could change it to fit their will, what would it look like? Well, it might look like, to use the terminology that we heard in generations past in the church, it might look like fun and frolic. It might look like games in the parking lot. It might look like huge buildings with social centers and with basketball courts, and maybe some tennis courts out back, and maybe a walking track for the community. Now, while the church is supposed to be active in the community, the church meaning the people, are supposed to be active in the community, we don't have any authority in the scriptures to do some of the many things that we see being done in the religious world around us. And it is pretty plain to see that those that engage in such activities are not following the law of Christ. We all have the word. In fact, I'm certain that, you know, the denominational churches down the road and those that are practicing all of these things, they probably have the very same, I'm certain they have the very same word in their pew Bibles and in their Bibles at home. But the difference is that the authority is not heeded. It's not understood. Maybe it's not understood, but at the very least, it is not something that they heed as strictly as the Lord would desire. You know, one of the basic things that we have to get into our minds before we are obedient to the law of Christ, before we are obedient to the gospel, is that God is allowed to say so because He made all things. He is all things. And the word that He's given us is a binding law. Now, we can get away with doing something in our daily life, and you know, we live through that day and wake up the next day and we think, well, I've gotten away with it because nothing happened to us. And we go through day after day of that. But at some point, we're going to be called and judged according to these very words. It is a binding law, and the authority that it carries with it is the authority of Christ. Something that we should never forget, and something that as gently and as boldly even as we can, we need to make sure that others know that. Because it's something that I didn't understand until I came to be taught by loving brethren in the Church of Christ. Years ago, I didn't think of it that way. Just as we mentioned this morning, the Ethiopian eunuch, when he was asked, do you understand what you're reading? He said, how can I understand these things unless someone guides me or teaches me? And that's exactly what we must do, one for another, to our neighbors, to our friends. And that authority is what we need to understand. Notice that when Philip taught the Ethiopian eunuch, what does it say he taught him? What did he talk to him about? What did he start with? He taught him about Christ. He taught him about Christ then and there. And that inevitably had to do a lot with the authority of Christ and who Christ is and why he has the ability to tell us what must be done. Moving on. Oh, well, let's read Revelation 22 since I put it there in the outline. Revelation 22, verse 18 beginning says, for I testify to everyone who hears the words of the prophecy of this book. If anyone adds to these things, God will add to him the plagues that are written in this book. And if anyone takes away from the words of the book of this prophecy, God shall take away his part from the book of life, from the holy city, and from the things which are written in this book. Now, it's very plain to see that the Lord desires that we heed his word just as it is written, and that we don't add our own thoughts into it. You know, we know from the scriptures that God's ways are higher than our ways, and that's something that we have to get a hold of. I've told you many times about the song that I remember hearing years ago, that some of the lyrics are, God is God, and I am not. And that's stuck in my head. And I think it's a good thing to have stuck in your head, that idea that God is God and you are not. Sometimes we need to knock ourselves down a couple notches and realize that in the vast array of things that mankind finds to worry about in the world, we are not in control. The thing that we are called to do is to be obedient to the Lord. The next thing that we can say about the law of Christ is that it is true and genuine. And how do we know that it's true? How do we understand that it's true? You know, John 17:17 reminds us that his word is truth. It says, sanctify them by your truth. Your word is truth. And remember earlier we talked about being sanctified in Christ. You go back to the beginning of John, we understand that Christ is the Word and was there in the beginning, and without him nothing was made that was made. The Word is truth, and it is true and genuine. And so here we have that statement, which tells us basically that it is the truth. But also, we understand that the truth of Christ's law is evident. And we've used this verse before. There are many applications for it, I suppose, but let's look at Romans 1 at verse 20 for a moment. It says, "For since the creation of the world, his invisible attributes are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse." When you look around you and you see the things that are created and you read about God creating these things in the beginning, when you study and understand that the Old Testament scriptures tell us that the earth hangs from nothing, and then here science tells us that, well, the earth, it hangs from nothing. That goes further to prove that these things that we read are true. And if you just pay attention, if you just pay attention and look around, the things that you see in the scriptures turn out to be true. When we look at the timelines of creation in the Bible, we see a timeline that is much shorter than scientific timelines that we've all been taught. But as time is going on, as we live long enough, Lord willing, we're starting to see that timeline of men is starting to shrink a little bit. There are some things, there are some scientists that are noticing some things which are debunking their old thoughts. And now they're not quite, in many cases, they're not quite ready to jump off the bandwagon and say, yes, the word of God is correct. But all of these things that they think about this very old earth are being debunked. And yet the word of God shows that it's true and has said that it was true for all this time. And if you just pay attention to the things that the law of Christ asks you to do, when it speaks of the things that Christians should do and how they should live their lives, the list of things that Christians should not do are on the list of every self-help guru out there that has written a book. The things that you should not give yourself over to, lasciviousness, drunkenness, all these things that we see that the book speaks against. We understand those things are harmful. In fact, when we really think about it, all of us, I'm sure, know somebody, or maybe we ourselves have been in the situation in times gone by where we have been under the power of some sin. We have been involved in perhaps illicit drugs and alcohol and who knows what else, because all of those things, as we understand, when we're listing, when the scriptures list off all of those things to avoid, it also says, "And such were some of you." And that reminds us that each and every one of us, we may have been dragged down in those things, but we can understand now from a distance that those things were bad. And the scriptures teach us that those things are detrimental to us. So if you pay attention and you read and you study and you look into the Word of God, you can understand that it is true and genuine. Because oftentimes you'll go to somebody who doesn't believe in the Word, and you'll say, "Well, John 17:17 says that his word is truth." And you'll go to Romans 1:20 and say, look out the window and look at all the beauty out there. You have to believe that there is a God. But if they're not in that place, they won't see it. They won't understand it. They have to be taught. They have to come to that realization for themselves. And sometimes that takes a long time. But if someone has an honest heart and honestly wants to look around them and compare what they're seeing in life to the scriptures, they will see that the things that they read are true and genuine. The law that we have in Christ is eternal. This, again, Christ was offered as a sacrifice once for all. There remains no more sacrifice after this. This is it. This is the last chance, if you will. And the Lord is, of course, as we understand, not slack concerning his return, but he's being patient with us that we might, each and every one, come to the knowledge of truth, that we might be obedient to him. This law is eternal. And Psalm 119 at verse 160 reminds us of that. The entirety of your word is truth, and every one of your righteous judgments endures forever. Try as we may to find a reason that we can change it or twist the word, his righteous judgments endure forever. And as we approach the end of our lives, each and every one of us, not a one of us is getting younger, not a one of us is getting healthier, so to speak. We might recover from an illness, but as we age, we are slowly dying. Just as God said in the beginning in the garden, he told Adam and Eve that dying they will die, and that's exactly what we are doing, each and every one of us. And as we approach the end of our days, this idea of his righteous judgments being eternal, this should either cause you great peace because you understand and you're in Christ and you are looking forward to reaping the benefits of those righteous judgments, or it should make you shake in your boots because you understand that you're outside of Christ. The law of Christ, again, is by his authority. It is the gospel that can save us, and it is true and genuine. And if you take a moment out of each and every day to look into the word, I believe you'll come to understand that it is true and it is genuine as well. So as we close out this time of thinking about the law of Christ, let's just look at 2 John at verse 9. It says, whoever transgresses and does not abide in the doctrine of Christ does not have God. He who abides in the doctrine of Christ has both the Father and the Son. Now again, thinking back there to the Psalms, where we read in Psalm 119 about his judgments being forever. So I ask you, as we close out this lesson, are you in Christ? Have you put on Christ in baptism? As I look around me, I see that most people have. But if you haven't, I ask you, why not? Maybe you'll see this message later on the recording, and if you're listening to this, why not put on Christ today? Why not seek out those that will help you to be in Christ this very day? Acts 22:16 tells us, and now why are you waiting? Arise and be baptized and wash away your sins, calling on the name of the Lord. If you're sitting here or listening and you are a Christian and you found that life has been difficult, and perhaps you've fallen away, perhaps you're just having a difficult time and you need the prayers of the saints. The Lord established his church and gave us each other so that we might be that support one to another. If you need the prayers of the saints, if you need the support and edification that can only come from Christ and his people, then by all means come forward as we stand and sing.